Being human at work. Bringing somatic intelligence into your professional life. Edited by Richard Strozzi-Heckler. Narrated by Kirk Magoon. Published by North Atlantic Books. Dedication. To Jack, Paloma, and Wesley. Introduction. We begin the 21st century dominated by a technological culture that, with remarkably few exceptions, has created social and economic institutions that treat people as instrumental means. Many of us live lives of ease and luxury, yet fewer and fewer of us can claim that what we are doing produces satisfaction. Even fewer seem able to answer with any depth the question, "What am I working so hard for?" The significant loss of productivity, innovation, and creativity at the workplace, not to mention the overwhelming despair that so many experience as a result of spending more than a third of their life in an activity that has little or no personal meaning, is a staggering cost to the human spirit. This alienation and fragmentation in modern life, as evidenced by the billion-dollar industries created by antidepressants, antacids, anxiety relievers, migraine medications, and flights to virtual worlds, suggests an inability to cope with the pressures of our personal and professional lives. The greatest cost of the specialization of technological life, and out of which all other damages are birthed, is arguably our separation from the practical and enriching sense of ourselves as embodied beings. When we are alienated from the wisdom of the body, our lives become theoretical and abstract, and we are distanced from the direct, felt sense of living. Our bodies become anxious, easily depressed, incapable of satisfaction, often ineffective, and victim to the purveyors of cosmetics, medicine, and the illusion of perpetual youth. Except as delivery mechanisms that haul our brains from meeting to meeting, from work to home and back again, our bodies have grown inconsequential. Even at the gym, our efforts to trim our bodies are mechanical and joyless. We become afflicted by a cultural amnesia and have forgotten that we are feeling, multidimensional beings, rather than extras in some corporate extravaganza. For the past 18 years at the Strozzi Institute, the Center for Leadership and Mastery, we have investigated, researched, and promoted a cogent and viable alternative to what ails us. It is a set of practices that allows the wisdom of our embodied humanity to lead the way. This doesn't mean, however, that productivity takes a back seat. Our research has shown that by empowering the individual with the skills of awareness, choice, commitment, and purposeful living, productivity and creativity increase. The essays in this anthology speak of somatics. Somatics is a Greek word that literally means the living body in its wholeness. It refers to the notion that humans have the capacity to be self-generating, self-healing, and self-educating. Our work at Strozzi Institute is strongly influenced by the discipline of somatics, as well as linguistics, martial arts, philosophy, neurobiology, body-oriented psychology, and meditation. Somatics is a set of practices that produces a centered presence in which we learn to be present to others while staying firmly grounded in what we care about, the capacity to generate, receive, and repair trust when we break it, empathy and respect for others, the ability to listen, the knowledge of what it is to be authentic, the ability to coordinate effectively with others, the desire to be lifelong learners. All the authors in this anthology have studied at the Institute. The one exception, Richard Leiter, is a longtime friend and collaborator who has taught at Strozzi Institute and have integrated this somatic work into their professional disciplines. Richard Leiter, a well-known author and consultant who has spent his entire career of more than 30 years studying purpose and calling, sets the tone for the book in the Career as Calling section when he asks, "Why do we do what we do?" Leiter argues that purpose is essential to our fulfillment in the workplace. Without it, we drift aimlessly. First, Leiter says, we need to respond to our natural desire to live a life of meaning and satisfaction. In the Leading the Way section, I describe a learning environment within organizations that develops the self as the fundamental source of power for leaders. I propose that the self is indistinguishable from the body, and that training the body teaches the leadership skills necessary to build effective teams and trust among customers and colleagues. Judith Rosenberg has been training leaders in low-income neighborhoods throughout the United States and Latin America to build sustainable, self-generating communities for almost 2 decades. Her work opens social implications in leadership training for people of color and the economically disadvantaged. Ariana Strozzi uses horses to create an innovative approach to building leadership skills with individuals and teams. In her essay, she shares lessons learned about leadership when her clients interact with horses. Robert Dunham, a former executive at Motorola who heads his own consulting company, demonstrates how his method of teaching management skills allows people to make new behavioral choices instead of simply memorizing a set of management tips and techniques. Dunham argues that most MBA graduates are head smart, but ineffective when dealing with people. Woody Allen, not the actor as he is fond of saying, a lifelong athlete, has served as CEO, CFO, and chairman of a number of successful companies. He challenges us to adopt from sports training an ongoing set of practices to create more positive esprit in the workplace. Tom Lutz offers a compelling account of the challenges and joys of working with mood and emotion in the blue-collar population of a large Midwestern utilities company. We follow him as he transforms a resigned, disgruntled veteran of the production line into a self-reflective individual who embarks on a new way of life. Peter Lesmore, a Brit by birth, has a long-standing belief that people don't have to suffer at work to be productive and successful. He demonstrates how somatic practices can increase both productivity and joy in the workplace, teaching his clients that synchronizing and movement improves their business and fun. Executive coach and trainer Suzanne Zeman proposes a way of working somatically over the phone to create trust, connection, and a mood of learning. Her work belies our assumptions regarding how we engage electronically with others. New York State educator Peter Riley proposes a radical model for training teachers to contact and listen to their students more effectively. Examples from decades of teaching and observing the needs of his students illustrate that the way we teach can be as important as what we teach. Mary Wagner, prize-winning writer and teacher at San Francisco State University, describes the use of a somatic sensibility in helping young writers find their voice. To be a writer, she says, one must live with one's senses wide open. She shows how bringing aspiring writers into their bodies improves their craft and feeds their poetic imagination. Peter Denning, a godfather of the computing industry, claims that engineering departments have failed in teaching their students how to produce value in the marketplace. Denning has produced a curriculum for engineering students that teaches them how to listen deeply to the concerns of their customers. Karen Short, mother, parent educator, and consultant to schools, proposes that we've strayed from a fundamental common sense in how we relate to our children. She says that by learning the art of listening through our bodies, we will have more satisfying relationships with our children, and they will learn more quickly. Physician, poet, and hospice teacher Patrick Clary offers a new perspective for physicians working with death and dying. Clary describes his personal struggle confronting death in the jungles of Vietnam, during the Twin Towers tragedy, and with his individual clients. His is a moving account of a pioneer in the relatively new field of death and dying. Psychotherapist and teacher Denise Benson describes the challenges of including the body when working with adolescents. She shows how she skillfully introduced a teenage client to a somatic understanding of her body, increasing her confidence, self-esteem, and capacity for self-expression. Rich Posha, an accomplished martial artist and health professional, proposes that martial arts are a rich context to help those with addictions. This unconventional wisdom challenges both our notions about the martial arts and our ideas of how to approach those who are in treatment for addictive behaviors. In her work with couples, Paula Love uses movement and gesture to help her clients develop more effective communication. Working through the body, they learn practices they can use when the relationship begins to wobble. Boston psychotherapist and coach Jennifer Cohen demonstrates how trauma stays alive in the body. By paying attention to habituated reactions, her clients learn to integrate the fragmented parts of themselves more easily. J. Claire Bowen Davies, another psychotherapist and coach, shows how working with the body in alcohol recovery allows healing to be deeper and more consistent. She argues that a somatic element should become standard practice in recovery work. In her case study, we see how she counsels clients to experience the value of somatic practices. Jan Mundo has created a hands-on method of healing headaches that may revolutionize the migraine industry. Her effective method of banning headache pain also teaches her clients, physicians, nurses, health practitioners, and individuals, how they can work on themselves to ease their own pain. Psychotherapist and coach Michael Moran illustrates the subtlety and long-lasting effect of working through the body. He posits that a somatic approach is essential in producing deep and lasting change. Marine Captain John Duval writes about his experience in the Marine Warrior Project, the prototype for the present version called the Marine Martial Art. He speaks candidly about the value of facing fears for those in the military, and regards body-mind practices as fundamental for the training of the Marine of the 21st century.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.